For the next 7 weeks, I'm going to be backpacking with my mate James through Panama, Colombia, and Venezuela.
Come around the corner and see that, it's a whole nother level. It's the tallest waterfall in the world. Tomorrow we're going to go right up next to it, and we might even get to swim at the base of it. For fans of Up, this is the mountain that they use to create Paradise Falls. So, just this whole thing about me being super slow. Now, sure, I was carrying more weight for stopping the film, but let's not worry about that kind of stuff.
I had to stop to leave messages.
Hurry up, Karl.
You're such a dick!
That's James. He's gonna walk under the waterfall too.
This is our play.
Our journey began in Panama, where I met up with James, who'd already been traveling through Central America for 5 months.
We just met some random people, and they've seen HK2NY on YouTube.
Oh yes, we have! Inspired us to come here, made some videos.
Inspiration, you're welcome!
After having a week to work our way through Panama, we boarded a boat to sail for 5 days through the Caribbean paradise of the San Blas Islands.
The plan is we're gonna take that dinghy and row it over to James Island over there. It's really small.
You didn't seem that bad.
You're not allowed to come on my island if you don't have any rum.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Arriving in Colombia, we had a relaxing few days, building up a group of friends to join us on the 4-day trek through the jungle to the lost city of Tayuna.
It was so much fun just going through the jungle, going up and down, weaving out, crossing rivers.
It was very cool actually finally being here. Very Indiana Jonesy kind of vibe, wandering around these ruins in the jungle.
In Machu Picchu, you can get the bus up. Here, you have to earn it by doing the trek.
Made it here.
Need to find some more string, or whatever this stuff is.
After the trek, we headed to Palomino to unwind for a few days, before James and I left the group to head into Venezuela. We have a 2-week tour booked in Venezuela to take us to Angel Falls and Roraima Mountain. Our original plan was to take the 18-hour overnight bus across the border to the capital city of Caracas, where our tour begins and we'll immediately fly down to the national parks. We'd already seen warnings on the UK government's travel site advising against any travel through Venezuela's bordering states with Colombia due to drug trafficking, illegal armed groups, and kidnapping. However, we soon didn't even have a choice with the matter, as the Venezuelan government closed the entire border with Colombia. Venezuela's economy, being largely dependent on oil, is basically screwed. The government blamed the country's problems on illegal Colombian immigrants smuggling goods out of the country, which is why they closed the border. However, the opposition argues this is merely a distraction from the real issues. The government's manipulation of their currency, the bolivar, has led to a lack of production, making the country almost entirely dependent on imported goods. This has led to Venezuela having the world's largest inflation rate at over 100%, and on the black market, the bolivar lost 70% of its value. This made foreign goods incredibly expensive, leading to widespread shortages, with massive queues at supermarkets, only to find the shelves almost completely empty. How this affected James and I is, first off, all the backpackers we met thought we were nuts for going to Venezuela, given the state that it was in. And secondly, the only way to get into the country was to fly via Colombia's capital of Bogota.
Another South America bus, more salsa music, not as loud this time.
Fortunately, our Venezuela tour didn't start for a few days, so before we caught our flight, we gave ourselves some time to relax in the small Colombian village of Taganga.
So we had the last few days just chilling out here in Taganga, and the hostel we're staying at is absolutely gorgeous. Basically, it used to be a mansion for someone who was in the drug cartel or just a big-time drug dealer, and then obviously got arrested, and now it's been converted to a hostel, but it's gorgeous. Like, we're living in absolute luxury for £6 a night. So we basically got two of the old rooms, converted them to dorms, but we've got an amazing swimming pool, full kitchen, absolutely gorgeous. Cannot recommend this place enough. In fact, it's been so nice that we kind of just got stuck here rather than actually going out and seeing some of the surrounding places like Minca. One thing we did do was a day tour yesterday where we got to sort of hang out with the local community, got to meet this family and sort of learn about their history and how they live, which is really fascinating. But one of the limitations of when you're self-filming a documentary is that if I had a camera crew there and they were having a conversation with the family, they can just sort of back off and capture the conversation. But if I'm having a one-on-one conversation with someone and they're talking to me about their family, it's a bit rude to just stick a camera in their face and be like, carry on. So I couldn't really do that, but it was really amazing just learning a little bit more about the history and about how people live here. And then they took us to this beach where James got to do some cliff diving.
Well done, mate.
Did a bit of snorkeling, and then it was topped off by sort of helping out the local fishermen with like catching all the fish coming out of the sea.
I know why you say it to me.
Come on, Kaz, put you back into it.
It's
got miles to go, yeah. How much is a bucket of fish worth?
Depending on the fish. Yeah. Some fish are more expensive than the other one. Some fish could cost like 2,000, 3,000, depending also how big they are. This fish, it's cheap because it has many bones. It is called machuelo. Some people say it's like the sardina.
Yeah.
You know, sardina?
Yeah.
You know this? No, it's not the blowfish. I think you know that cowfish. You can see the arm. This is really hard. And in the sea, they change the color.
Mm. Oh, really?
Yeah.
What? Do the birds eat it?
I don't know.
Try it.
Let's see.
Yeah. Like, what the fuck's this?
It was a really cool day of actually sort of getting involved with the local people rather than just, you know, chilling out at the hostel with backpackers. And then today we're flying down to Bogota so we can get our flight to Venezuela. And the adventure carries on from there.
After a couple of nights in Bogota, we caught our flight to Caracas, where we met up with a representative from our tour company who put us on another flight to Puerto Ordaz, where we met up with a different guide who drove us to Ciudad Bolivar, from where we'll be flying down tomorrow to Canaima National Park. Basically, it was a shitload of traveling in a short space of time.
We've had a very long day, so we're pretty knackered. Tomorrow we're going to see Angel Falls, so that's going to be awesome. But one interesting thing that did happen today, this sort of live room experience, was getting the Venezuelan money. Because basically the guy who picked us up said, oh, do you want to change some money? He'll give us like a good black market rate. So we went into this white van with blacked out windows. I thought we might have balaclavas put over our heads for a second. And then he just drove around the block by the airport and switched up our money. James checking right now whether he gave us a good deal. We think he did. But the sizes of the wads of cash we weren't expecting. So I'll let James tell some more.
Well, I thought he was joking when he said, here you go. Here's 100, and here's another 100. And we're like, nah, that's not right. So I have to count it all to see what rate we got, which is not going to be fun. I'll start again now, because Carl's interrupting me.
Yeah, there you go.
The only way in to Canaima National Park is by plane, so we had a short 45-minute flight before we made our way to the boats that will take us upstream to Angel Falls.
Getting on a boat for 4 hours, heading that way. Race is on, guys!
Bye-bye!
Since it was a 4-hour journey upstream, we made a few stop-offs along the way.
It's a fucking awesome swimming spot. We're going on fire. James is right here. The fucking tree. You bang your head on the way in, though.
What, you about to drink, Dave?
I don't know. Some
yuca?
alcoholic potato juice or something. Poured out of
a tank over there.
Oh, you can smell the alcohol.
How is it?
Have you ever been like thrown up McDonald's fries? That taste you have in your mouth?
Amazing.
Try it.
No, no, no.
Just have a sip, honestly. It's not as bad as I said it was.
I threw up this morning anyway.
Oh, come on, just.
That's just what it's like.
Oh. Have you tried it? It tastes like miso soup.
I thought it tastes like what it tastes like when you throw up McDonald's fries. It's like potato, but not very nice.
With one last stretch up the river, we turn a corner and suddenly, right in front of us was Angel Falls, the highest waterfall in the world.
We've been seeing waterfalls all day, but you come around the corner and see that, it's a whole nother level. It's just incredible. All day we're going, is that Angel Falls? Is that it? And then it's like, oh no, no, wait, no, no, that's definitely it.
What is it said? Can't see how Angel Falls is going to top all these other waterfalls.
Yeah, and then you see it, it's like, all right, that's how. The 4-hour journey was getting pretty tiring by the end. I was like, yep, I'm over this now. But then you finally see it and it's just, it's unbelievable. What do you think of it, mate?
Amazing. Spectacular.
You see photos of it and stuff, and you know that it's going to be the tallest one in the world, but nothing beats actually seeing it for yourself.
Nearly up there with Guazi Falls, I think.
Yeah, it's a good rival to Guazi Falls.
Well, just the journey and all the other falls that we've sort of seen on the way, take it all into the pack.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just incredible. And with the clouds hugging the mountains as well, it just has like nice mystical feeling. It's just beautiful. Best of tomorrow, we're going to go right up next to it, and we might even get to swim at the base of it, depending on the weather. This is our campsite for tonight, more hammocks. Tonight for dinner, we're going to be eating chicken.
What do they say about it?
Chicken's so rare in Venezuela like at the moment. It's like a delicacy.
Imagine we got beer with it, then we'll be eating
chicken and beer, yeah.
But they've got a different way of cooking chicken to the way we do, which they're going to show us. They're just going to put it right by the fire and let the fire flames cook it. So it should taste pretty sweet.
Yeah.
After a relatively decent night's sleep in the hammocks, we cross the river to begin the hour-long walk up to the base of Angel Falls. With a height of 979 meters, Angel Falls is the highest uninterrupted waterfall in the world.
Well, we've made it to the main viewpoint to make sure you don't slip on the rocks and fall off to your death, but it's pretty spectacular. It's weird how the waterfall doesn't even seem to hit the bottom, it just turns to mist, but hits all the rocks and then gradually turns into that massive river.
It's like someone's cut. I love the stats.
Yeah, you can only sometimes see the top because the clouds are moving past so fast, so sort of trying to get the perfect photo takes a lot of patience.
It's like water falling from a cloud.
I thought you could say it's like water falling from somewhere higher up. It's like, yeah, that's a waterfall.
What do they call these things?
It's still unbelievably spectacular.
The falls were named after American aviator Jimmy Angel, who was the first person to fly over it in 1933 and then crash-landed on top of it a few years later. The original indigenous name for the falls is Kerepakupai Vena, which I'm pretty sure isn't how you pronounce it. But either way, it means waterfall of the deepest place.
We're going to go swimming at the base of the tallest waterfall in the world. It's not quite the base of it, it's as close as we can get. And we didn't have showers at the campsite this morning, so basically it's like the world's most extravagant shower. How's the climb?
Shower of beer.
Shower of beer. Do it, boys.
No!
Once we freshened up in the shower of beer, we made our way back down to find the skies had cleared, giving us the best view of the falls yet.
Well, back down the bottom for the best view of the day. Jungle actually looks like English meadows now, but it's been quality. It's a bit hard going that walk though, so you got to watch every single step you're doing. We don't want to twist our ankle before the trek, but first test of the DCs.
New hiking shoes.
New hiking shoes.
They stood up to their typical standard quality.
See how they are in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
The good weather didn't last though, as a thunderstorm kicked in for our four-hour boat journey back down the river.
But yeah, we were on a boat through a thunderstorm for like an hour, hailing down, freezing cold. Then we had to walk over the bit the boat couldn't go down. Then all the paths turned to rivers. I smacked the hell out of my foot. But now we're back.
That was completely fucked.
Your lips on film as well.
If anyone saw my picture when I wore a bin bag up Costa Rica Mountain instead of this, this is the reason why. Just keeping the water in.
The next day, we had one more waterfall to check out, except this time from a different angle.
This right here is the waterfall that we're going to walk underneath. That's James. There he is. He's going to walk under the waterfall too.
I've gone underneath that.
Venezuela's Guinness factory, just going for a little dip. James is trying to make a shamrock. I think it's because of all the iron in the water, that's why it says colour. I could be wrong.
Beer
factory. Oh yeah, this is the beer factory.
Drink it. Do you get it?
Yeah, get a pint. it didn't happen because it wasn't on camera.
That afternoon, we had to fly back out of the national park, and we were a little surprised at the size of our plane.
This is our plane. If it's two pilots, four passengers, that's what we're flying back in.
It's going to be awesome.
This is without a doubt the smallest plane I've ever been in.
Give me a tip. Tip for the pilot, $1.
The waterfall?
In a minute, it's going to look amazing. That's amazing.
This guy just went like right over the airport and then over the waterfall turning like that. He just suddenly felt the geez, yeah. It was so much fun.
Do it.
Heading straight towards some storm clouds. Could be interesting.
Touching down in Ciudad Bolivar, we caught an overnight bus to take us to Santa Elena, the last destination of our trip. From here, we had a day tour around the Gran Sabana, which took us to yet more waterfalls, and James obtained an injury he could have done without.
How do you manage that?
Not the best timing, since we're about to do the trek to the lost world of Roraima Mountain. Now, if you've seen the film Up, they journey to a fictional place in Venezuela called Paradise Falls. When the animators were making the film, they came to Roraima to base their designs on the mountain and just stuck Angel Falls on the end to get the best of both worlds. Obviously, we don't have a flying house to get us there, which means it's a 6-day trek to the top of the mountain and back.
We are about to start the Roraima trek. Had a bit of, well, a lot of innovation from James. He's designed me a double backpack. It's my camera and stuff. I've always got too much shit. So I've got a sleeping bag and one bag. Great work from James. And then new hiking boots. And then we got his mattress tied to a sleeping bag.
Find some more magic rope.
Magic rope to help him out. And he's sporting his wig and shirt for the trek. I guess someone's got to achieve something in a wig and shirt this year. So,
oh-ho. I got the essentials.
Essentials, well, rum.
What?
We are good to go.
My makeshift backpack setup lasted less than 5 minutes, so I went for the front and back look instead. There were 6 of us in our group, and since we didn't start the trek until the afternoon, we had just a 3-hour walk to our first campsite. And as the sun went down, we found ourselves surrounded by the sparkle of fireflies.
It's morning here at the campsite. You see so many stars last night, it's pretty cool. I could film the stars alright with my camera, but taking photos of them, it can handle it really well. But the only problem is I didn't have a tripod, so I was just balancing it on my shoe, so it's not quite in focus, but they're pretty good. Then I sat up like shit, because the ground was like fucking concrete. And also they said, oh, if you drink the water at the river, it's fine. But I'll leave it up to your imagination what happened to me 12 hours after that. And today we're going to be walking to the base of up there.
Despite being tired and ill, we managed to do the half day's walk to the base camp in less than 3 hours. And frustratingly, the plan was to wait around until the next morning to walk to the top of the mountain.
We walked for a good 3 hours this morning. We got here about 11. Basically, that's the top up there. It's a 3 hours walk. We could do it now, but we're doing it tomorrow. So,
well, we could have got. I would have been here at 10:30. I could have been up there at like
2.
Well, less, for rest. 10:30, 11:30. I could have been up there too. Yeah, easy. Like.
Oh well.
It's a nice stroll.
Yeah, it's a nice easy pace. This is where it actually starts to get interesting. So we're gonna go all the way up there, finally get to the top. Another day and a half up there. 22 hours a bit at this campsite. So looking forward to getting up there and seeing what we paid for.
One of the reasons we were frustrated with the pace was because we were so keen to get to the top. Exploring Roraima Mountain is something I've been dreaming about for years, and James, who was walking ahead of me, left me some encouraging messages to keep me going.
Hurry up, Karl. What, Dick? Getting pretty high up now. View is just spectacular. Bags are pain in the ass, though. I've just seen the scramble we've got to do. We've got to scramble up there. Try not to fall down there. So we can get up there. I can see James at the top. That little dot up there.
You're such a dick!
Made it to the top. It's James waiting and mocking.
Hi guys. How long have you been here? 3 hours?
So, just this whole thing about me being super slow. Now, yes, I did get up here 45 minutes after James. James did an hour 45, it's very good going. So it took me 2.5 hours. Now, the suggested time for how long it takes is 4 hours, so I still did it pretty good. And sure, I was carrying more weight, felt stopping the film, but let's not worry about that stuff.
I had to stop to leave messages. That took me like half an hour.
Adjusting my bag. But let's not worry about these facts. The only other person who beat me up from the group was Klaus, who's ex-military. And then the rest
is carrying 15k.
Who's ex-military. And then the rest of the group got up here 2 hours after me. So just putting it in a bit of context, that's all. But yes, James is very quick. Well done, James.
You were just slow.
Now, somewhere up here is our campsite. Fuck knows where, though. Pretty awesome view, though. Almost worth it. It's a bit of a maze up here.
Anyone seen the campsite? Now, as far as picnic spots go, this is pretty decent.
Bad lunch up here yesterday as well.
Could have done, yeah.
Bit dizzy sat up here.
Bit of vertigo.
A little bit, yeah. It's quite high.
Nice little viewpoint for James.
A bit wobbly.
Someone has stolen our campsite spot. So, just waiting for one of the guides to get some more food, and then it's going to be a 45-minute walk that way to our spot. But it's supposed to be by some cool caves and stuff, so it should be good. But it's crazy just how silent it is here. I mean, the only sound right now is just me monologuing, which is beautiful, but...
can't call him Kermit, he's not green.
Black Kermit.
Black Kermit. Put him back in the water.
I thought you were just going to flick him off for a second. It's hinting it might start raining, so James has got a little poncho on.
It's an upgrade from my bin bag.
It's true. True. Covers his bag.
Got my swim shorts on, just in case it gets wet.
Obviously it costs like 20p as well. Heading to the campsite, which means heading to shelter. So looking forward to just exploring around, really. Our campsite is just tucking that little crave down there. It's a really cool spot, actually. Nice and sheltered and dry, pretty warm. Show you our campsite for the night. Yeah. Oh, this is cool. Wow. So this is our home for the night. Pretty awesome camp spot.
The best thing about our campsite, we were just 2 minutes walk from this spectacular view.
Good view?
Don't push me.
I'm not going right to the end. I get vertigo watching you doing it.
Look at Klaus.
I know.
That's a guy who doesn't give a shit. Army man.
It looks scary up here.
Yeah.
It does. Like, I didn't realise it was that bad.
Yeah.
So I just came over and just saw, oh, there's a little bit you could sit there. From here, it looks ridiculous.
I'm fine where I am, just fine. Enjoying the view, enjoying life, it's just good. What is it, like 1,000 meters rough?
Oh, yeah.
So when you look at James's photos on Facebook of this compared to mine, you'll see James about a meter closer to the edge than me. Because I got close enough for what I like. It's fucking scary. It's beautiful, but scary. Oh, I have to come back with my GoPro and just put like the... because you get a shot just going over the edge. It's a 1 kilometer drop.
Yeah.
And when you look over the edge, oh, fucking scary. Chef's cooking up some special hot chocolate. Awesome. The thing I noticed about the reverse side of James's hat is it's a bunch of llamas smelling each other's shit. It's kind of disgusting, really. That llama's done a shit. That one's smelling the shit. That one's done a shit. That one's smelling the
shit. Leave me alone.
Cannot tell you how happy I am to have shelter. If we were out in the open now, we'd be stuck in our tents, fucking miserable, but we're here. Hot chocolate, biscuits. Life is good.
Our bodies were aching from another terrible night's sleep lying on the rock-solid floor, but it was all worth it to wake up to this. After breakfast, we head out to explore the mountain. The top of Roraima covers an area of 31 square kilometers, which includes Venezuela's border with Guyana and Brazil. geological formations are considered some of the oldest on Earth, dating back to around 2 billion years ago, and many of the plant species can be found nowhere else on the planet.
This turtle rock. It's a camel rock.
Is the value of the crystals, and despite there being loads, you're not allowed to take any. Lois Gilberto gets suspended.
No good.
All of you have backpack, right? Well, we can put another crystal in your backpack.
Oh. I don't mind if they suspend me for 3 years.
I've got that on video now, mate. You're fucked. It's like anywhere in the world, you don't actually take the stuff, you just leave it where it is so other people can enjoy it. And you can buy very similar things in town anyway.
Gilberto's official advice, take the crystals.
Don't worry about his job, just take the crystals.
Whole place is just like a giant playground, just loads of things to explore and see. There's caves, there's jacuzzis, there's, you know, valleys of crystals. It's amazing. It's just spectacular. It's like nothing I've ever seen before, which I guess was the whole point of coming here, really. But I love it.
So when the clouds are on there, you can see all the way down.
This is jacuzzi.
It's time to brave the lovely warm jacuzzi. Really cold. Oh. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you could do it that way.
I can't believe you cannonballed in here. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Nice relaxing jacuzzi.
Place is like a labyrinth of rocks. You could so easily get lost here. It's a complete maze. I think if we didn't have a guide, we'd be fucked. I'll throw a stone down and see how long it takes to hear it.
I didn't hit the bottom.
Yeah, just got you over, got any more? You just want to just go like this.
Yes.
It's a bet.
Huh?
Bet. The word is bat, the animal.
There are some bats.
Bat.
Bat?
No.
Nope.
As in Batman.
Like Batman. Yeah. Ah, si, Batman. Bat, of course.
Swear to me.
Time to go exploring a cave.
Can you find a light? James?
Yeah?
Where's that?
What is what?
It's what?
What is that? What is that?
Gold.
It is gold, certainly.
Whoa! Pretty cool.
It reminds me of that film, The Sack. Have you seen it?
Yeah.
Oh.
That was a bit mental, a bit different.
Yeah.
A few hairy jumps, but otherwise it's alright. Didn't expect it was going to be like that at all though. Just thought it'd be like a little cave view. Didn't think we'd actually go exploring all the way down.
And gold.
We found some gold. Gold! I love gold.
Well, we had an amazing day exploring around Roraima. It's such a cool place. There's so many incredible things to see. It's such a weird, unique landscape. Like I said, it's like a labyrinth. You could easily get lost, but it's so beautiful. I'm so glad we came here. Now we've got 2 days trekking to get back. And it's kind of like, once we got down, you're over it really. You just want to get back. But we're going to be trekking all day tomorrow, camping again, and then trekking, and then finally get back. So that's going to suck a little bit, but I guess that's what you got to do to get up here.
Since we had all day to get down to the campsite, we made a small detour on the way back.
Made it to the highest point on Roraima Mountain.
Just down there's the bottom.
Klaus has got a flag, but James is going to put the highest stone on the cairn to claim the highest point of the mountain.
Oh, I'm going to make the highest picture. I'm going to do it with a flower and a stone. It's like Jenga. Oh, yes! I claim the highest point.
Much better.
Oh, I'm proud of my work. How many people are going to come up and love that?
No!
The slightest gust of wind, just the slightest breeze, it's gone.
As we started walking down, it only took me 20 minutes to sustain an injury.
On the way down, just below the cliffs of Roraima Mountain, I slipped and twisted my ankle. My right foot slipped on this rock and hit a root of a branch and it got caught and I went over. So I've basically been slowly hobbling down, which is why I haven't really been filming. It's not really fucked up, but it hurts quite a bit. And so James decided to leave another message for me. And I mean, James, you know, he's my best friend and he's a really sensitive guy. And I think one word this describes him is empathy. He really sort of understands how you're feeling inside and sort of gets into your soul and just, he knows, you know? It's like a brotherly love. So he's left me this message saying, hurry up, Karl, again. So yeah, thank you, James. That's beautiful. I will hurry up and I'll get there soon. Just try not to get too lonely without me. It's basically a massive thunderstorm on Roraima Mountain. It usually hugs the mountain, but it looks like it might be coming its way slowly. So it's a question of what's going to move faster, the slow thunderstorm cloud or me hobbling along with my bad ankle. What will happen first? Will I get to the camp or will I get soaked? Maybe this is why James left the message to say, hurry up, Karl, you could foresee this. He was actually looking out for me. Made it back to the campsite. James here, my lovely, lovely best friend, left his lovely message for me, looking out for me. Missed the storm, it just turned away. So, and now we got.
Oh yeah, that's why I left the message.
That's definitely why they messed the message. You know, just looking out for me. He's a nice guy. And now we got to sit here until the morning, until we can walk the last 3 hours. But there you go. So I just go for a little wash in the river. Hobbling back, and James has to make one more message.
Left him one more message. So what do we say to Karl? Hurry up.
Has to tell me one more time to hurry up.
Look at him. Look how slow this man is.
I'm injured. I've twisted my ankle. But it doesn't stop James from, you know, having my back and supporting me.
This is what I have to put up with all the time. Look how slow this guy is. What do we think, Max? Is this guy slow?
Look, this tape is not slowing.
This is a minute long now. This is how long it's taking you to walk up that hill. Guys, full of excuses.
We had one last night of camping before walking back to the start point, which was the end of the trek and essentially the end of our trip.
We've made it to the end of the trek. Finally got a beer. It's Polar Light, which normally would taste like piss, but because it's been 6 days, it tastes all right.
I'd buy some more.
There wasn't any real climax to this trip because after the trek, we just had a long week of waiting around and slowly working our way back up to Caracas so that I could catch my flight home and James could fly back to Colombia to carry on with his trip. But overall, it doesn't really matter because I just had the best time in these 7 weeks and I got everything out of it that I wanted to do. Like, I got to sail through the San Blas Islands in the Caribbean, I got to do the trek to the Lost City in Colombia, and we checked out Angel Falls and Roraima in Venezuela.
All day we're going, is that Angel Falls? Is that it? And then it's like, oh no, no, wait, no, no, that's definitely it.
And obviously, there's loads more things we could have done, especially in Colombia, and not just the country as a whole, but even in the area we were in, there was tons more things to see and do. And if we were doing this trip at the same pace as HK to NY, we probably would have tried to squeeze it all in. But this time, it was great just to have these four things that we wanted to do, and then around that, just take it easy, hang out, make some really cool friends, get drunk together, and just have an awesome time.
Just give it one try.
So I'll definitely have to come back and see more of Colombia at some point. And as for Venezuela, I'm not going to pretend to know exactly what's going on there. I mean, we were certainly sheltered from any of the problems because we were just doing the touristy stuff. But all I can say is everyone we met was super nice, super friendly. The guys on our trek looked after us so well with endless enthusiasm. So I hope the country can sort itself out, not obviously just for their sakes, but also to encourage more people to visit there, because it's such a beautiful country and different to anything I've experienced anywhere else in the world. And James, he went back to Colombia and carried on working his way down through South America, and he's ended up spending a lot longer there than he originally planned because we finished this trip in September 2015. It's now April 2016 and he's still there. But I know wherever he is, he'll always be traveling with the same joy, enthusiasm and grace that he always has. So when I look back now, there's no doubt that the HK to NY trip completely changed our lives. I mean, beforehand, James had barely traveled, and now he's off having more adventures than he ever dreamed of. And for me, I didn't even know if anyone's gonna watch those videos, but now, off the back of the success of my YouTube channel, it's led to me working at STA Travel to edit their videos. Plus, I'm still getting to do plenty of traveling. So in January, I went to India. This summer, I'm off to Africa. Plus next month, Chris and I are going back to Nepal to complete our quest for Everest by doing the base camp trek. And as for when I'll next see James, I don't know. The boring version is he'll get tired and run out of money and has to come home.
Look how slow this man is. This is what I have to put up with all the time.
What a dick.
I know for sure we'll definitely do more trips together in the future, so hopefully the next time I see him won't be in England. We'll just meet up somewhere and go off on another adventure. But yeah, he's still a dick.